Let fame, all hunt after in their lives, live registered upon our brazen tombs, and grace us in the disgrace of death, when, spite of cormorant devouring time, the endeavor of this present breath shall buy that honor which shall bait his scythe's keen edge, and make us heirs of all eternity. Therefore, brave conquerors, for so you are, at war against your own affections, and the huge army of the world's desires, our late edict shall strongly stand in force. Navarre shall be the wonder of the world. Our court shall be a little academe, still and contemplative in living art. You three, Biron, Dumain, and Longueville, have sworn for 3 years' term to live with me, my fellow scholars, and to keep those statutes recorded in this schedule here. Your oaths are passed. And now subscribe your names, that his own hand may strike his honor down that violates the smallest branch herein. If you are armed to do as sworn to do, subscribe to your deep oath, and keep it too.
I am resolved. Tis but a 3 years fast. The mind shall banquet, though the body pine. Fat paunches have lean pates, and dainty bits make rich the ribs, but bankrupt quite the wits.
My loving lord, Dumain is mortified. The grosser manner of these world's delights he throws upon the gross world's baser slaves. To love, to wealth, to pomp, I pine and die, with all these living in philosophy.
I can but say their protestation over. So much, dear liege, have I already sworn, that is to live and study here 3 years. But
there are other strict observances, as not to see a woman in that time, which I hope well is not enrolled there, and one day in a week to touch no food, and but one meal on every day beside, which I hope is not enrolled there, and then to sleep but 3 hours in the night, and not to be seen to wink of all the day. But I was wont to think no harm all night, and make a dark night too of half the day, the which I hope well is not enrolled there. For these are barren tasks, too hard to keep.
Not to see ladies, study, fast, not sleep.
Your oath is passed to pass away from these.
Well, let me say no, my liege, if you please. I only swore to study with your grace and stay here in your court for 3 years' space.
You swore to that, Biron, and to the rest.
Ah, by yea and nay, sir, then I swore in jest. What is the end of study?
Let me know.
Why, that to know which else we should not know.
Things hid and barred, you mean, from common sense?
Ah, that is study's godlike recompense.
Come on, then. I'll swear to study so. To know the thing I am forbid to know, as thus, to study where I well may dine, when I to feast expressly am forbid, or study where to meet some mistress fine, when mistresses from common sense are hid, or having sworn too hard a keeping oath, study to break it and not break my troth. If study's gain be thus and this be so, study knows that which yet it doth not know. Swear me to this, and I will ne'er say no.
These be the stocks that hinder study quite, and train our intellects to vain delight.
Why, all delights are vain, but that most vain, which with pain purchased, doth inherit pain. As painfully to pore upon a book to seek the light of truth, while truth the while doth falsely blind the eyesight of his look. Light seeking light doth light of light beguile. So ere you find where light and darkness lies, your light grows dark by losing of your eyes. Study me how to please the eye indeed, by fixing it upon a fairer eye, who dazzling so that eye shall be his heed, and give him light that it was blinded by. Study is like the heaven's glorious sun that will not be deep searched with saucy looks. Small have continual plotters ever won, save base authority from others' books. These earthly godfathers of heaven's lights, that give a name to every fixed star, have no more profit of their shining nights than those that walk and wot not what they are. Too much to know is to know not to fame,
And every godfather can give a name.
How well he's read to reason against reading.
Proceeded well to stop all good proceeding.
He weeds the corn and still lets grow the weeding.
The spring is near when green geese are breeding.
How follows that?
Fit in his place and time.
In reason, nothing.
Something then in rhyme.
Her own is like an envious, sneeping frost that bites the first-born infants of the spring.
Well, say I am. Why should proud summer boast before the birds have any cause to sing? Why should I joy in any abortive birth? At Christmas, I no more desire a rose than wish a snow in May's newfangled mirth, but light of each thing that in season grows. So you, to study now, 'tis too late. Climb o'er the house to unlock the little gate.
Well, sit you out. Go home, Biron. Adieu.
No, my lord. I have sworn to stay with you. And though I have for barbarism spoke more than for that angel knowledge you can say, yet confident I'll keep what I have swore and bide the penance of each 3 years' day. Give me the paper. Let me read the same, and to the strictest decrees I'll write my name.
How well this yielding rescues thee from shame.
Item, that no woman shall come within a mile of my court. Hath this been proclaimed?
4 days ago.
Well, let's see the penalty. On pain of losing her tongue. Who devised this penalty?
Marry, that did I.
Sweet lord, and why?
To fright them hence with that dread penalty.
A dangerous law against gentility. Item. If any man be seen to talk with a woman within the term of 3 years, he shall endure such public shame as the rest of the court can possibly devise. This article my liege yourself must break. For well you know, here comes an embassy, the French king's daughter with yourself to speak. A maid of grace and complete majesty, about surrender up of Aquitaine to a decrepit, sick, and bedrid father. Therefore, this article is made in vain, or vainly comes the admired princess hither.
What say you, lord? Why, this was quite forgot.
So study evermore is overshot. While it doth study to have what it would, it doth forget to do the thing it should.
We must perforce dispense with this decree. Well, she must lie here, on mere necessity.
Necessity will make us forsworn 3,000 times within this 3 years' space, for every man with his effects is born. Not by might mastered, but by special grace. If I break faith, this word shall speak for me. I am forsworn on mere necessity. So to the laws at large I write my name. And he that breaks them in the least degree stands in attainder of eternal shame. Suggestions are to other as to me, but I believe, although I seem so loath, I am the last that will last keep his oath. But is there no quick recreation granted?
Aye, that there is. Our court, you know, is haunted with a refined traveler of Spain, a man in all the world's new fashion planted that hath a mint of phrases in his brain, one whom the music of his own vain tongue doth ravish like enchanting harmony. A man of compliments, whom right and wrong have chose as umpire for their mutiny. This child of fancy that Armado hight, for interim to our studies, shall relate in high-born words the worth of many a knight from tawny Spain, lost in the world's debate. How you delight, my lords, I know not I, but I protest I love to hear him lie, and I will use him for my minstrelsy.
Armado is a most illustrious wight, a man of fire new words, fashion's own knight.
Tuft of the swain, and he shall be our sport. And so to study 3 years is but short.
Which is the Duke's own person?
This fellow, what words?
For I myself reprehend his own person, for I'm his grace to Starborough. But I would see his own person in flesh and blood.
This is he.
So, Senor, command you. There's villainy abroad. This letter will tell you more.
Sir, the contents thereof are as touching me.
A letter from the magnificent Armado.
How low soever the matter, I hope in God for high words.
A high hope for a low heaven. God grant us patience.
To hear or forbear laughing?
To hear meekly, sir, and to laugh moderately, or to forbear both.
Well, sir, be it as the style, she give us call to climb the ladder.
The matter is to me, sir. It's concerning Giacquinetta. The manner of it is, I was taken with the manner.
In what manner?
Well, in manner and form following. All those three. Well, I was seen with her in the manor house, sitting with her upon the form, and taken following her into the park, which put together is manor and form following.
Now, sir, for the manner. Well, it is the manner of a man to speak to a woman. For the form, in some form.
For the following, sir?
As it shall follow in my correction. God defend the right.
Will you hear this letter with attention?
As we will hear it, Oracle.
Such is the simplicity of man to hearken after the flesh.
Great deputy, the Welkins, vicegerent, and sole dominator of Navarre, my soul's earth god and body's fostering patron.
Not a word of custard yet.
So it is.
It may be so. But if he say it is so, he isn't telling true, but so.
Peace.
Be to me and every man that dares not fight.
No words.
Of other men's secrets,
so,
I beseech you.
So it is. Besieged with sable-colored melancholy, I did commend the black oppressing humor to the most wholesome physic of thy health-giving air. And as I am a gentleman, betook myself to walk. The time when? About the 6th hour, when beasts most graze, birds best peck, and men sit down to that nourishment which is called supper. So much for the time when. Now for the ground which. Which, I mean, I walked upon. It is yclept thy park. Then, for the place where. Where, I mean, I did encounter that obscene and most preposterous event that draweth from my snow-white pen the ebon-colored ink, which here thou viewest, beholdest, surveyest, or seest. But to the place where. It standeth north-northeast, and by east, from the west corner of thy curious knotted garden. There did I see that low-spirited swain, that base minnow of thy mirth.
Me?
That unlettered, small-knowing soul.
Me?
That shallow vassal.
Still me?
Which, as I remember, hight Custard.
Oh, me.
Sorted and consorted, contrary to thy established proclaimed edict and continent canon, with this I passion to say, where with?
With a wench.
With a child of our grandmother Eve, a female. Or, for thy more sweet understanding, a woman. Him I, as my ever-esteemed duty pricks me on, have sent to thee to receive the meed of punishment by thy sweet grace's officer, Anthony Dow, a man of good repute, carriage, bearing, and estimation.
I, and it please you, I am Anthony Dow.
For Jacquinetta, so is the weaker vessel called, which I apprehended with the aforesaid swain, I keep her as a vessel of thy law's fury, and shall at the least of thy sweet notice bring her to trial. Thine in all compliments of devoted and heart-burning heat of duty, Don Adriano de Amado.
This is not so well as I looked for, but the best that ever I heard.
Why, the best for the worst. But, sirrah, what say you to this?
Sir, I do confess the wench.
Did you not hear the proclamation?
Well, I do confess much of the hearing of it, but little of the marking of it.
Well, it was proclaimed a year's imprisonment to be taken with a wench.
Oh, well, I was taken with none, sir. I was taken with a damsel.
Well, it was proclaimed damsel.
Well, this was no damsel neither, sir. She was a virgin.
It was so varied, it was proclaimed virgin.
If it were, I deny her virginity. She was a maid.
This maid will not serve your turn, sir.
This maid will serve my turn, sir.
Sir, I will pronounce your sentence. You shall fast a week on bread and water.
I had rather pray a month on mutton and porridge.
And Donald Mother shall be your keeper. My Lord Verone, see him delivered o'er. And go, we lords, to put in practice that which each to other have so strongly sworn.
I'll lay my head to any good man's hat. These oaths and laws will prove an idle scorn. Sirrah, come on.
I suffer for the truth, sir. For true it was I was taken with Jacquinetta. And Jacquinetta is a true girl. Therefore, welcome the sour cup of prosperity. Affliction may one day smile again. Till then, sit thee down, sorrow.
Why, what sign is it when a man of great spirit grows melancholy?
A great sign, sir, that he will look sad.
Why, sadness is one and the self-same thing, dear Eve.
No, no! Oh, Lord, sir, no!
How canst thou part sadness and melancholy, my tender Juvenal?
By a familiar demonstration of the working, my tough senor?
Why, tough senor? Why, tough senor?
Why, tender juvenile? Why, tender juvenile?
I spoke it, tender juvenile, as a congruent epitheton appertaining to thy young days, which we may nominate tender.
And I, tough senor, as an appurtenant title to your old time, which we may name tough.
Pretty and apt.
How mean you, sir? I pretty in my saying apt, or I apt in my saying pretty?
Thou pretty because little.
Little pretty because little. Wherefore apt?
And therefore apt because quick.
Speak you this in my praise, master?
In thy condign praise.
I will praise an eel with the same praise.
What? That an eel is ingenious?
That an eel is quick.
I do say thou art quick in answers. Thou heatest my blood.
I'm answered, sir.
I love not to be crossed.
He speaks the mere contrary. Crosses love not him.
I promise to study 3 years with the Duke.
You may do it in an hour, sir.
Impossible.
How many is one thrice told?
I am ill at reckoning. It fitteth the spirit of a tapster.
You are a gentleman and a gamester, sir.
I confess both. They are both the varnish of the complete man.
Then I'm sure you know how much the gross sum of douces amounts to.
It doth amount to one more than two.
Which the base vulgar do call three.
True.
Why, sir, is this such a piece of study? Now here is three studied ale, thrice wit.
A most fine figure.
To prove you a cipher.
I will hereupon confess, I am in love. And as it is base for a soldier to love, so I am in love with a base wench. If, drawing my sword against the humor of affection, would deliver me to the reprobate thought of it, I would take desire prisoner and ransom him to any French courtier for a new devised courtesy. I think scorn to sigh. Methinks I should outswear Cupid. Comfort me, boy. What great men have been in love.
Hercules, master.
The most sweet Hercules. More authority, dear boy. Nay more. And, sweet my child, let them be men of good repute and carriage.
Samson, master. He was a man of good carriage. Great carriage, for he carried the town gates on his back like a porter. And he was in love...
Oh, well, neat Samson. Strong-jointed Samson. I do excel thee in my rapier as much as thou didst me in carrying gates. I have been loved, too. Who was Samson's love, my dear Moat?
A woman, master.
Of what complexion?
Of all the four, or the three, or the two, or one of the four.
Tell me precisely of what complexion?
Of the seawater green, sir.
Is that one of the four complexions?
As I have read, sir, and one of the best of them, too.
Green, indeed, is the color of lovers. But to have a love of that color... methinks Samson had small reason for it. He surely affected her for her wit. My love is most immaculate, white, and red.
Most immaculate thoughts, master, are masked under such colors.
Define, define, well-educated infant.
My father's wit and my mother's tongue assist me.
Sweet invocation of a child, most pretty and pathetic.
If she be made of white and red, her faults will ne'er be known. For blushing cheeks by faults are bred, and fears by pale white shown. Then if she fear or be to blame, by this you shall not know. For still her cheeks possess the same which natives she doth owe. A dangerous rhyme, master, against the reason of white and red.
Boy. I do love that country girl that I took in the park with the rational hind Costab. She deserves well.
To be whipped, and yet a better love than my master.
Sing, boy. My spirit grows heavy in love.
And that's great marvel, loving a light wench.
I say sing.
Forbear till this company be passed.
Sir, the Duke's pleasure is that you keep Costard safe. And you must suffer him to take no delight or no penance. And he must fast 3 days a week. For the damsel here, I'm to keep her at the park. She's in love with the dye woman. Very well.
To betray myself with blushing. Maid.
Man.
I will visit thee at the lodge.
That's hereby.
I know where it is situate.
Lord, how wise you are.
I will tell thee wonders.
With that face?
I love thee.
So I heard you say.
And so, farewell.
Farewell, they're after you.
Come, Jack, we're not away. Villain! Thou shalt pass for thy offences and thou be pardoned.
Well, sir, I hope when I do it, I shall do it on a full stomach.
Thou shalt be heavily punished.
I am more bound to you than your fellows, sir, for they are but lightly rewarded.
Well, take away these feelings. Shove him up.
Come, you transgressing slave, away!
Oh, let me not be pent up, sir. I shall fast being loose.
No, sir, that were fast and loose, thou shalt to prison.
Well, if ever I do see the merry days of desolation that I have seen, some shall see.
What shall some see?
Nay, nothing, Master Mole, but what they look upon. It is not for prisoners to be too silent in their words, and therefore I will say nothing. I thank God I have as little patience as the next man, and therefore can keep quiet.
Come, ow! You friend!
Ow! 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 Ow!
I do affect the very ground which is base, when her shoe which is baser, guided by her foot which is basest, doth tread. I shall be forsworn, which is a great argument of falsehood, if I love. And how can that be true love, which is falsely attempted? Love is a familiar. Love is a devil. There is no evil angel but love. Yet was Samson so tempted, and he had an excellent strength. Yet was Solomon so seduced, and he had a very good wit. Oh, Cupid's butt shaft is too hard for Hercules' club. And therefore, too much odds for a Spaniard's rapier. The first and second cause will not save my turn. The passado he respects not, the duello he regards not. His disgrace is to be called a boy, but his glory is to subdue men. Adieu, valor. Arrest rapier, be still, drum, for your manager. He's in love. Yea, he loveth. Assist me, some extemporal god of rhyme, for I am sure I shall turn sonnet. Devise wit, write pen, for I am for whole volumes in folio.
Your dearest spirits, consider who the king your father sends, to whom he sends, and what's his embassy. Yourself, held precious in the world's esteem, to parley with the sole inheritor of all perfection that a man may owe, matchless Navarre, the plea of no less weight than Aquitaine, a dowry for a queen. Be now as prodigal of all dear grace as nature was in making graces dear, when she did starve the general world beside, and prodigally gave them all to you.
Good Lord Boyette, my beauty, though but mean, needs not the painted flourish of your praise. Beauty is bought by the judgment of the eye, not uttered by base sale of chapmen's tongues. I am less proud to hear you tell my worth than you much willing to be counted wise in spending your wit in praise of mine. But now to task the tasker. Good Boyette, you are not ignorant. All telling fame doth noise abroad that Navarre hath made a bar. Till painful study shall outwear 3 years, no woman may approach his silent courts. Therefore, to us seemeth it a needful course, before we enter his forbidden gates, to know his pleasure. And in that behalf, bold of your worthiness, we single you as our best moving fair solicitor. Tell him that the daughter of the King of France, on serious business, craving quick dispatch, importunes personal conference with his grace. He signifies so much, whilst we attend like humble busied suitors his high will.
Proud of employment, willingly I go.
All pride is willing pride, and yours is so. Poor the Beaufries, my loving lords, that are vile fellows with this virtuous duke.
Lord Longueville is one.
Who know you, the man?
I know him, madam. At a marriage feast between Lord Perigot and the beauteous heir of Jacques Falconbridge, solemnized in Normandy, saw I this Longueville. A man of sovereign parts he is esteemed, well fitted in art, glorious in arms. Nothing becomes him ill that he would well. The only soil of his fair virtue's gloss, and if virtue's gloss will stain with any soil, is a sharp wit, matched with too blunt a will, whose edge hath power to cut, whose will still wills it should none spare that come within his power.
Some merry mocking lord belike, is so?
They say so most, that most his humours know.
Such short-lived wits do wither as they grow.
Who are the rest? The young humane, a well-accomplished youth, of all that virtue loved, for virtue loved, most poor to do most harm, least knowing ill. For he hath wit to make an ill shape good, and shape to win grace, though he had no wit. I saw him at the Duke of Lensan's once, and much too little of that good I saw is my report to his great worthiness.
Another of these students at the time was there with him, if I have heard a truth. Biron they called him, but a merrier man within the limit of becoming mirth I never spent an hour's talk withal. His eye begets occasion for his wit, for every object that the one doth catch, the other turns to a mirth-moving jest, which his fair tongue, conceit's expositor, delivers in such apt and gracious words that aged ears play truant at his tales, and younger hearings are quite ravished. So sweet and voluble is his discourse.
God bless my ladies. Are they all in love? Did every one her own hath garnished it with such bedecking ornaments of praise?
Here comes Boyette.
Oh, now, what admittance, lord?
Navarre had notice of your fair approach, and he and his competitors and oath were all addressed to meet you, gentle lady, before I came. Marry, thus much have I learnt. He rather means to lodge you in the field like one who comes here to besiege his court, then seek a dispensation for his oath to let you enter his unpeopled house. Here comes Navarre.
Fair princess, welcome to the court of Navarre.
Fair, I give you back again, and welcome I have not yet. The roof of this court is too high to be yours, and welcome to the wide fields, too base to be mine.
Madam, you shall be welcome to my court.
I will be welcome, then. Conduct me thither.
Hear me, dear lady. I have sworn an oath.
Our lady, help my lord. He'll be forsworn.
Not for the world, fair madam, by my will.
My will shall break it. Will and nothing else.
Your ladyship is ignorant what it is.
Were my lord so, his ignorance were wise. Where now his knowledge must prove ignorance. I hear your grace hath sworn out housekeeping. Tis deadly sin to keep that oath, my lord, and sin to break it. Oh, but pardon me, I am too sudden bold. To teach a teacher ill beseemeth me. Vouchsafe to read the purpose of my coming, and suddenly resolve me in my suit.
Madam, I will, if suddenly I may.
You were the sooner that I were away, for you'll prove perjured if you make me stay.
Did not I dance with you in Brabant once?
Did not I dance with you in Brabant once?
I know you did.
How needless was it then to ask the question?
You must not be so quick.
'Tis long of you that spur me with such questions.
Your wit's too hot, it spurs too fast, 'twill tire.
Not till it leave the rider in the mire.
What time of day?
The hour that fools should ask.
Now fair, before your mask.
Fair fall the face it covers.
And send you many lovers.
Amen, so you be none.
Nay, then will I be gone.
Madam, your father here doth intimate the payment of 100,000 crowns, being but the one half of an entire sum dispersed by my father in his wars. But say that he or we, as neither have received that sum, yet there remains unpaid 100,000 crowns, in surety of the which one part of Aquitaine is bound to us, although not valued at the money's worth. If then the king, your father, will restore but that one half which is yet unsatisfied, we will yield up our right in Aquitaine and hold fair friendship with his majesty. But that, it seems, he little purposeth. For here he doth demand to have repaid 100,000 crowns, and not demands on payment of 100,000 crowns to have his title live in Aquitaine, which we much rather had depart withal, and have the money by our father lent than Aquitaine so gelded as it is. Dear Princess, were not his request so far from reason's yielding, your own fair self should make a yielding against some reason in my breast, and go well satisfied to France again.
You do the king, my father, too much wrong, and wrong the reputation of your name, in so unseeming to confess receipt of that which hath so faithfully been paid.
I do protest I never heard of it, and if you prove it, I'll repay it back, or yield up Aquitaine.
We arrest your word. Boyette, you can produce acquittances for such a sum from special officers of Charles, his father.
Satisfy me so.
So please, your grace, the packet has not come where that and other specialties are bound. Tomorrow you shall have the sight of them.
It shall suffice me. At which interview, all liberal reason I will yield unto. Meantime, receive such welcome at my hand as honor, without breach of honor, may make tender up to thy true worthiness. You may not come, fair princess, in my gates, but here without you shall be so lodged as you may deem yourself received in my heart, though so denied fair harbor in my house. Your own fair thoughts accuse me, and farewell. Tomorrow shall we visit you again.
Sweet health and fair desires consult your grace.
Thy own wish I thee in every place.
Lady, I will commend you to mine own heart.
Oh, pray you do my commendation. Glad to see it.
I would, you heard it groan.
Is the fool sick?
Sick at the heart.
A nap-letty blood.
Would that do it good?
My physic says I.
Will you prick it with your eye?
No point. With my knife.
Now God save thy life.
And yours from long living.
Oh, I cannot stay Thanksgiving.
Sir, I pray you a word. What lady is that same? The heir of Alençon, Catherine, her name.
A gallant lady. Monsieur, fare you well.
I beseech you, sir, a word. What is she in the white?
A woman sometimes, and you saw her in the light.
Perchance light in the light. I desire her name.
She hath but one for herself. To desire that were a shame.
Pray you, sir, whose daughter?
Her mother's, I have heard.
God's blessings on your fears.
But, sir, be not offended. She is an heir of Falconbridge.
Nay, my collar is ended. She is a most sweet lady.
Not unlike, sir, that may be.
What's her name in the cap?
Rosaline, by good hap.
Is she wedded or no?
To her will, sir, also.
You are welcome, sir. Adieu.
Farewell to me, sir, and welcome to you.
That last is Barone, the merry madcap lord. Not a word with him, but a jest.
And every jest but a word.
It was well done of you to take him at his word.
And I was as willing to grapple as he was to board.
Two hot sheeps, Mary.
And wherefore not ships? No sheep, sweet lamb, unless we feed on your lips.
You sheep and I pasture. Shall that finish the jest?
So you grant pasture for me?
Not so, gentle beast. My lips are no common, though several they be.
Belonging to whom?
To my fortunes and me.
Good wits will be jangling, but gentles agree. This civil war of wits were much better used in Navarre and his bookmen. For here it is a view.
If my observation, which very seldom lies, by the heart still rhetoric disclosed with eyes, deceive me not now, Navarre is infected.
With what?
With that which we lovers entitle affected.
Your reason?
Why, all his behaviors did make their retire to the corner of his eye, pitting thorough desire. His tongue, all impatient to speak and not see, did stumble in haste in his eyesight to be. Methought all his senses were locked in his eye, as jewels in crystal for some prince to buy. I'll give you Aquitaine and all that is his, and you give him for my sake but one loving kiss.
Come to our pavilion, Boyette is disposed.
Don't you speak that in words which his eye hath disclosed. I only have made a tongue, a mouth of his eye, by adding a tongue which I know will not lie.
Thou art an old love-father, and thou speak skill.
He's Cupid's grandfather, and earned beauty.
Oh, then with Venus like a mother, for her father is but grim.
Do you hear, my man, Mercutus? No. What then do you see?
I await to be gone.
Oh, you're too hard for me.
Warble, child, make passionate my sense of hearing.
Sweet air, go, tenderness of years, take this key, give enlargement to this wain, bring him fastenedly hither. I must employ him in a letter to my love.
A message well sympathized, a horse to be ambassador for an ass.
What sayest thou?
Marry, sir, you must send the ass upon the horse, for he is very slow-gated, but I go.
The way is but short away.
As swift as lead, sir.
The meaning pretty ingenious. Is not lead a metal heavy, dull, and slow?
Mirror, my honest master. Or rather, master, no.
No, I say lead is slow.
You are too swift, sir, to say so. Is that lead slow which is fired from a gun?
Sweet smoke of rhetoric. He reputes me a cannon, and the bullet, that's he. I shoot thee at the swain.
Thump, then, and I flee.
A most acute juvenile, voluble and free of grace. By thy favor, sweet Welkin, I must sigh in thy face. Most rude melancholy, valor gives thee place. My herald is returned.
Wonder, master, here's a cusp and broken in a shin.
Some enigma, some riddle. Come, thine envoy, begin.
Oh, no enigma, sir, no riddle, no l'envoy, no salve in the mail, sir. Oh, sir, a plantain, a plain plantain, sir. No enigma, no riddle, sir, but a plantain.
My virtue, thou enforcest laughter. Thy silly thought, my spleen, the heaving of my lungs provokes me to ridiculous smiling. Oh, pardon me, my stars. Doth the inconsiderate take salve for l'envoy and the word l'envoy for a salve?
Do the wise think the matter? Is not l'envoy a salve?
No, page. It is an epilogue or discourse to make plain some obscure precedents which have tofore been seen. I will example it. The fox, the ape, and the humble bee were still at odds, being but three. There's the moral. Now the larva.
I will add the l'envoy. Do you say the moral again?
The fox and the ape and the humble bee were still at odds, being but three.
Until the goose came out of door and stayed the odds by adding four. Now will I begin your moral, and do you follow with my l'envoy?
The fox, the ape, and the humble bee were still at odds, being but three.
Until the goose came out of door, staying the odds by adding four.
A good l'envoy ending in the goose. Would you desire more?
The boy hath sold him a bargain. A goose, that's flat. Sir, your pennyworth be good and your goose be fat. To sell a bargain well is as cunning as fast and loose. Let me see. A fat l'envoy. Aye, that's a fat goose.
Come hither, come hither. How did this argument begin?
By saying that a costard was broken in a shin, then called you for the l'envoy.
Joe and I for a plantain. Thus came your argument in. Then the boy's fat l'envoy, the goose that you bought, and he ended the market.
But tell me, how was there a costard broken in the shin?
I will tell you sensibly.
Thou hast no feeling of it, Moat. I will speak that l'envoy. I costard, running out that was safely within, fell over the threshold and broke my shin.
We will talk no more of this matter.
Aye, till there be more matter in the shin.
Sir Costard, I will enfranchise thee.
Oh, marry me to one Francis? I smell some goose, some l'envoy in this.
By my sweet soul, I mean setting thee at liberty and freedoming thy person. Thou art immured, restrained, captivated, bound.
True, true. And now you will be my purgation and let me loose.
I give thee thy liberty. Set thee from durance. And in lieu thereof, impose on thee nothing but this. Bear this significant to the country maid, Jacquinetta. Here is remuneration for the best ward of mine honor is rewarding my dependence. Note. Hello!
Like the sequel, I...
costard. Adieu.
My sweet ounce of man's flesh. My incanny Jew. Now will I look to his remuneration.
Oh, remuneration. Why, that's the Latin word for 3 farthings. 3 farthings, remuneration. What's the price of this inkle? 1 penny? No, I'll give you a remuneration. Why, it carries it. 'Tis a fairer name than French crown. Oh, I'll never buy and sell out of this word.
Oh, my good knave Costard, exceedingly well met.
I pray you, sir, how much carnation ribbon may a man buy for a remuneration?
What is a remuneration?
Oh, marry, sir, 8 penny farthing.
Why, then 3 farthing worth of silk.
Oh, I thank your worship. God be with you.
Stay, slave. I must employ thee. As thou wilt win my favor, good my knave, do one thing for me that I shall entreat.
When would you have it done, sir?
This afternoon.
Well, I will do it, sir. Fay,
thou knowest not what it is.
I shall know, sir, when I have done it.
Villain, thou must know first.
I'll come to your worship tomorrow morning.
It must be done this afternoon. Mark, slave, it is but this. The princess comes to hunt here in the park. And in her train there is a gentle lady. When tongues speak sweetly, then they name her name. And Rosaline they call her. Ask for her. And to our white hand, see thou deliver this sealed up counsel. There's thy guerdon. Go.
Oh, most sweet garden. Better than remuneration. 11 pence farthing better. I will do it, sir, in print. Garden. Remuneration.
And I, forsooth, in love. I, that have been love's whip. A very beetle to a humorous sigh. A critic, nay, a night watch constable, a domineering pedant o'er the boy, than whom no mortal so magnificent. This wimpled, whining, purblind, wayward boy, this senior junior, giant dwarf, Dan Cupid, regent of love rhymes, lord of folded arms, the anointed sovereign of sighs and groans, liege of all loiterers and malcontents, dread prince of plackets, king of codpieces, sole imperator and great general to trotting parators. Oh, my little heart. And I to be a corporal of his field and wear his colors like a tumbler's hoop. What, I? I love? I sue? I seek a wife? A woman that is like a German clock, still a repairing, ever out of frame, and never going aright. Being a watch, but being watched that it may still go right. Nay, to be perjured, which is worst of all, and among three to love the worst of all, a whitely wanton with a velvet brow, with 2 pitchballs stuck in her face for eyes. Aye, and one that will do the deed, though Argus were her eunuch and her guard. And I, to sigh for her, to watch for her, to pray for her. Go to it, as a plague that Cupid will impose for my neglect of his almighty, dreadful little might. Well, I will love, write, sigh, pray, sue, and groan. Some men must love my lady, and some Joan.
Was that the king that sprang his horse so hard against the steep uprising of the hill?
I know not, but I think it was not he.
Whoever it was, it showed a mounting mark. Well, lords, today we shall have our dispatch, and on Saturday we will return to France. Then, Forester, my friend, where is the bush that we must stand and play the murderer in?
Hereby, upon the edge of yonder coppice, madam, a stand where you may make the fairest shoot.
I thank my beauty, I am fair that shoot. And thereupon thou speaks the fairest shoot.
Pardon me, madam, for I meant not so. I was talking about the coppice.
What? First praise me and again say no. Oh, short-lived pride. Not fair. Alack for world.
Yes, madam, fair.
Nay, but never paint me now. Where fair is not, praise cannot mend the brow. Here, good my glass. Take this for telling true. Fair payment for foul words is more than due.
Nothing but fair is that which you inherit.
See, see, my beauty will be saved by merit. But come, Nouveau!
Your mercy goes to kill, and shooting well is then accounted ill. Thus will I save my credit in the shoot. Not wounding, pity would not let me do it. If wounding, then it was to show my skill that more for praise than purpose meant to kill. And out of question, so it is sometimes. Glory grows guilty of detested crimes, as I for praise alone now seek to spill the poor dear's blood, that my heart means no ill.
Do not, cursed wives, hold that self-sovereignty only for praise sake, when they strive to be lords or their lords?
Only for praise. And praise we may afford to any lady that subdues a lord.
Here comes a member of the Commonwealth. God dig you, Denol. Pray you, which is the head lady?
Thou shalt know her, fellow, by the rest that have no head.
Which is the greatest lady? The highest?
The thickest and the tallest.
The thickest and the tallest. Oh, it is so, and truth is truth. And were your waist, mistress, as slender as my wit, one of these maid's girdles for your waist should fit. Oh, are you not the head lady? You are the thickest here.
What is your will, sir? What is your will?
I have a letter from Monsieur Barone to one Lady Rosaline.
Oh, thy letter, thy letter! He's a good friend of mine. Good bearer, stand aside. Boyette, you can carve. Bring up this cake.
I have found her, sir. This letter is mistook. It importeth none here. It is writ to one Jackanetta.
Oh, read it, I swear. Break the neck of the wax, and everyone give ear.
By heaven that thou art fair is most infallible. True that thou art beauteous. Truth itself that thou art lovely. More fairer than fair, beautiful than beauteous, truer than truth itself, have commiseration on thy heroical vassal. The magnanimous and most illustrious King Cophetua set eye upon the pernicious and indubitable beggar Xenelophon, and he it was that might rightly say, weeny, weedy, weaky. Which to anatomize in the vulgar, O base and obscure vulgar, bid elicit, he came, saw, and overcame. The conclusion is victory. On whose side? The king's. The captive is enriched. On whose side? The beggar's. The catastrophe is a nuptial. On whose side? The king's? No. On both in one, or one in both. I am the king, for so stands the comparison. Thou the beggar, for so witnesseth thy lowliness. Shall I command thy love? I may. Shall I enforce thy love? I could. Shall I entreat thy love? I will. What shalt thou exchange for rags, robes, for titles, titles, for thyself, me? Thus, expecting thy reply, I profane my lips on thy foot, my eyes on thy picture, and my heart on thy every part. Thine in the dearest design of industry, Don Adriano de Armada.
What plume of feathers is he that indited this letter? What vane, what weathercock? Did you ever hear the better? Thou, fellow, a word. Who gave thee this letter?
I told you, my lord.
To whom shouldst thou give it?
From my lord to my lady.
From which lord to which lady?
From my lord Barone, a good master of mine, to a lady of France he called Rosaline.
Oh, thou hast mistaken his letter. Come, lords, away. Here, sweet, put up this. It'll be thine another day.
Who is the shooter? Who is the shooter?
Shall I teach you to know?
Aye, my continent's beauty.
Why, she that bears the bow, finely put on.
My lady goes to kill horns, but if thou marry, hang me by the neck of horns that year miscarry, finely put on.
Well then, I
am the shooter.
And who is your dear?
If we choose by the horns, yourself.
Come not near. Finely put on, indeed.
You still wrangle with her, Boyette, and she strikes at the brown.
But she herself is hit lower. Have I hit her now?
Shall I come upon thee with an old saying that was a man when King Pepin of France was a little boy as touching the hit it?
So I can answer thee with one as old that was a woman when Queen Guinevere of Britain was a little wench as touching the hit it.
Thou canst not hit it, hit it, hit it, thou canst not hit it, my good man.
And I cannot, 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 and I cannot another can. By my soul, a swain, thou most simple clown. Lord, Lord, how the ladies and I have put him down. By my troth, most sweet jests, most infinitely vulgar wit, when it comes so smoothly off, so obscenely as it were, so fit. Our motto on the one side, oh, a most dainty man. To see him walk before his lady, and to bear her fan, to see him kiss his hand, and how most sweetly he will swear. And his page on the other side, that handful of wit, oh heavens, it is a most pathetical knit. Sola! Sola!
Very reverend spoke, truly, and done in the testimony of a good conscience.
The deer was, as you know, sanguine in blood, ripe as a pomawater that hangeth like a jewel in the ear of Caleb. The sky, the welkin, the heaven,
to be sure,
and anon falleth like a crab on the face of terror. The soil, the land, the earth.
Truly, Master Holofernes, the epithets are sweetly varied, like a scholar at the least. But, sir, I assure ye, it was a buck of the first head.
Sir Nathaniel, hard credo, hard credo.
It was not a hard credo, it was a pricking.
Most barbarous intimation, and yet a kind of insinuation, as it were, in via, in way of explication. Fartere, as it were, a replication, or rather, ostentere, to show, as it were, his inclination. After his undressed, unpolished, uneducated, unpruned, untrained, or rather unlettered, or rather as unconfirmed fashion, to insert again my hard credo for a deer.
I said the deer was not a hard credo, it was a pricket.
Twice, sad simplicity, discoctus.
Discoctus.
Oh, thou monster ignorance, how deformed dost thou look.
Sir, he hath never fed of the dainties that are bred in a book. He hath not ate paper, as it were. He hath not drunk ink. He is only an animal, only sensible in the duller part. And such barren fruits are placed before us that we thankful should be, which we of taste and feeling are, for those things that do fructify in us more than he. For as it would ill become me to be vain, indiscreet, or a fool, so were there a patch set on learning to see him in a school. But domne bene, say I, being of an old father's mind, many can brook the weather that love not the wine.
You two are bookmen. Can you tell me by your wits what was a month old at Cain's birth? That is not 5 weeks old as yet.
Dictina, good man, though. Dictina, good man, though.
What is Dictorno?
A title to Phoebe, to Luna, to the moon.
The moon was a month old when Adam was no more. It wrought not to 5 weeks when he came to 50. The illusion holds in the exchange.
'Tis true indeed. The collusion holds in the exchange.
God comfort thy capacity. I say the allusion holds in the exchange.
And do I say the pollution holds in the exchange? For the moon is never but a month old.
Precisely.
And I said beside, it was a pricket that the princess killed.
Sir Nathaniel, Could you hear an extemporal epitaph on the death of the deer? And to humor the ignorant, I shall call the deer the princess killed a pricket.
Perge, good master Holofernes, perge, so it shall please you to abrogate scurrility.
I shall somewhat affect the letter P, for it argues facility. The prayful princess pierced and pricked a pretty pleasing pricket. Some say a sore, but not a sore, till now made sore from shooting. The dogs did yell, put L to sore. Then sorrel jumps from thicket, or pricket sore, or else sorrel, the people fall a-shooting. If sore be sore, then L to sore makes 50 sores one sorrel. Of one sore I 100 make, by adding but one more L.
More L?
By adding but one more L.
A rare talent.
This is a little gift I have, simple, simple. A foolish, extravagant spirit full of forms, figures, shapes, objects, ideas, apprehensions, motions, revolutions. It begot in the ventricle of memory, nourished in the womb of Pia Mater, and delivered upon the mellowing of occasion. But the gift is a good one in those in whom it is acute, and I am thankful for it.
Sir, I thank God for you, and so may my parishioners, for their sons are well tutored by you, and their daughters profit very greatly under you. You are a good member of the Commonwealth.
May her train. If their sons be ingenuous, they shall want not of instruction. If their daughters are capable, I shall put it to them. Well, but dear Sabbath, keep hot and open. A soul feminine salute us.
Oh, I give you good morrow, Master Parson. Oh, good Master Parson, be so good as read me this letter. It was given me by Custer and sent me from Don Armado. I beseech you, read it.
Hauste precor gelida, quando pecus omne sub umbra ruminat. And so forth. Ah, good old Mantuan, good old Mantuan. I may speak of thee as the traveler doth of Venice. Venetia, Venetia, che non te pretia, non te ve. Old Mantuan, who understandeth thee not, loves thee not. Utre sol fa la mia. Under pardon, sir, what are the contents? Or rather, as Horace says, what, my soul? Verses?
Aye, sir, and very learned.
Let me hear a staff, a stanza, a verse. Lege, Domine.
If love make me forsworn, how shall I swear to love? Ah, never faith could hold, if not to beauty vowed. Though to myself forsworn, to thee I'll faithful prove. Those thoughts to me were oaks, to thee like osiers bowed. Study his bias leaves, and makes his book thine eyes, where all those pleasures live that art would comprehend. If knowledge be the mark, to know thee shall suffice. Well learned is that tongue that well can thee commend. All ignorant that soul that sees thee without wonder, which is to me some praise that I thy parts admire. Thy eye Jove's lightning bears, thy voice his dreadful thunder, which not to anger bent is music and sweet fire. Celestial as thou art, O pardon, love, this wrong that sings heaven's praise with such an earthly tongue.
Sir, you find not the apostrophes and therefore miss the accent. Let me supervise the canzonet. Here are only numbers ratified. But for the elegancy, facility, and golden cadence of poesy, correct. Ovidius Naso was the man.
Ovidius Naso.
But, Damosella Birch. Damosella Birch, was this directed to you?
Aye, sir.
I shall overglance the superscript. To the snow-white hand of the most beauteous lady, Rosaline. I shall look again on the intellect of the letter for the nomination of the party writing to the person written unto. Your ladyship's in all desired employment, Birone. Sir Nathaniel, this Birone is one of the votaries of the king, and here he hath framed a letter to a sequent of the stranger queens, which, accidentally, or by way of progression, hath miscarried. Trip and go, my sweet. Deliver this to the royal hand of the king. It may concern much. Stay not thy compliment. I forgive thy duty. Adieu.
Sir, go with me. Sir, God save your life.
Have with me, girl.
Sir, you have done this very religiously. And as a certain father saith...
Sir, tell not me of the farce. I do fear colorable columns. But to return to the verses. Did they please you, Sir Nathaniel?
Marvelous well. For the pen.
Sir, I do dine today at the father's of a certain pupil of mine, where, if before repast, it shall please you to grace the table with a grace, I shall, under privilege I have, with the parents of the foresaid child or pupil, undertake your benvenuto, where I shall prove those verses to be very unlearned, neither savoring of poetry, wit, nor invention. I beseech your society.
Thank you, too. For society, saith the text, is the happiness of life.
And certes, the text infallibly concludes it. Sir, sir, I do invite you to. You shall not say me nay. Pauca verba, away. The gentles are at their game, and we will to our recreation.
The king, he is hunting the deer. I am coursing myself. They have pitched a toil. I am toiling in a pitch. Pitch that defiles. Defile. Foul word. Well, set thee down, sorrow. For so they say the fool said, and so say I, and I the fool. Well proved, wit. By the Lord, this love is as mad as Ajax. It kills sheep. It kills me. I a sheep? Well proved again on my side. By heaven, I will not love. If I do hang, in faith, I will not. Oh, but her eye. By this light, were it not for her eye, I would not love her. Yes, for her two eyes. Oh, well. I do nothing in the world but lie and lie in my throat. By heaven, I do love. And it hath taught me to rhyme and to be melancholy. Here is part of my rhyme, and here my melancholy. Oh, by the world. I would not care a pin if the other three were in. Here comes one with a paper.
God give him grace to grow.
Ay me.
Shot by heaven. Proceed, sweet Cupid. Thou hast thumped him with thy bird bolt under the left pap. In faith, secrets.
So sweet a kiss the golden sun gives not to those fresh morning drops upon the rose as doth thy eye beams,
when their fresh rays have smote the night of dew that on my cheeks downflows. Nor shines the silver moon one half so bright through the transparent bosom of the deep as doth thy face through tears of mine give light. Thou shinest in every tear that I do weep. No drop but as a coach doth carry thee. So ridest thou, triumphing in my woe. Do but behold the tears that swell in me, and they thy glory and my grief will show. But do not love thyself. Then thou wilt keep my tears for glasses and still make me weep. Oh, queen of queens, how far dost thou excel? No thought can think, nor tongue of mortal tell. How shall she know my griefs? I'll drop it on the ground. Sweet leaves, shade, folly. Oh, he's coming here. Longer villain reading. Listen here.
Oh, and I like this one more fool up here.
Ay, me, I am forsworn.
Why, he comes in like a perjurer wearing papers.
In love, I hope. Sweet fellowship and shame.
One drunkard loves another of the name.
Am I the first that have been perjured so?
I could put thee in comfort, not by two that I know.
I fear these stubborn lines lack power to move. Oh, sweet Maria, empress of my love. These numbers will I tear and write in prose.
Your rhymes are gods on wanton Cupid's hose. Disfigure not his slop.
This same shall go. Did not the heavenly rhetoric of thine eye, against whom the world cannot hold argument, persuade my heart to this false perjury? Vows for thee broke deserve not punishment. A woman I forswore, but I will prove, thou being a goddess, I forswore not thee. My vow was earthly, thou a heavenly love. Thy grace being gain cures all disgrace in me. Vows are but breath, and breath a vapor is. Then thou, fair sun, which on my earth dost shine, exhales this vapor vow. In thee it is. If broken then, it is no fault of mine. If by me broke, what fool is not so wise to lose an oath to win a paradise?
This is the liver vein. It makes flesh a deity, a green goose a goddess. Pure, pure idolatry. God amend us. God amend, we are much out of the way.
By whom shall I send this? Company, stay.
All hid, and all infants pray. Like a demigod, here sit I in the sky, and wretched fools' secrets heedfully o'er I. More sacks to the mill. For heavens, I have my wish. Dumain transformed, four woodcocks in a dish.
O most divine cape!
O most profane coxcomb!
By heaven, the wonder in a mortal eye!
By earth, she is not. Corporal, there you lie.
Her amber hair, for foul hath amber quoted.
An amber-colored raven were well noted.
As upright as a cedar.
Stoop, I say, her shoulder is with child.
As fair as day.
Aye, some days, but then no sun must shine.
Oh, that I had my wish.
And I had mine.
And I mine too, good lord.
Amen, so I had mine. Is not that a good word?
Once more I read the ode that I have written.
Once more I'll mark how love can vary wit.
On a day, alack the day, love whose month is ever May, spied a blossom passing fair, playing in the wanton air. Through the velvet leaves the wind all unseen can passage find, that the lover, sick to death, wish himself the heaven's breath. Air, quoth he, thy cheeks may blow. Ere would I might triumph so. But alack, my hand is sworn ne'er to pluck thee from thy thorn. Vow alack for youth unmeet, youth so apt to pluck a sweet. Oh, do not call it sin in me that I am forsworn for thee. Thou for whom Jove would swear, Juno but an Ethiope were, and deny himself for Jove, turning mortal for thy love. This will I send,
and something else more plain that shall express my true love's fasting pain.
Oh, would the king, Biron, and Blongerville were lovers too? Ill to example ill would from my forehead wipe a perjured note. For none offend, we're all alike, Dudo.
Dumaine, thy love is far from charity, that in love's grief desireth society. Oh, you may look pale, but I should blush, I know, to be our herd and take a napping so.
Come, sir, your blush, as here's your case is such. You chided him offending twice as much. You do not love Maria? Longueville did never sonnet for her sake compile, nor lay his wreathed arms athwart his loving breast to keep down his heart. I have been closely shrouded in this bush, and mocked you both, and for you both did blush. I heard your guilty rhymes, observed your fashion, saw sighs reek from you, noted well your passion. Oh, me, says one. Oh, Jove, the other cried. One, a hair's for gold. Crystal, the other's eyes. You would for paradise break faith and troth, and Jove for your love would infringe an oath. Oh. What will Biron say when he shall hear faith so infringed which such zeal did swear? How will he scorn? How will he spend his wit? How will he triumph, leap, and laugh at it? Oh, for all the wealth that ever I did see, I would not have him know so much by me.
Now step I forth to whip hypocrisy. Ah, good my liege, I prithee pardon me. Good heart, what grace hath done thus to approve these worms for loving that are most in love? Your eyes to make no coaches? In your tears there is no certain princess that appears? You'll not be perjured. 'Tis a hateful thing. Tosh! None but minstrels like of sonneting. But are you not ashamed? Nay, are you not all three of you to be thus much o'ershot? You found his boat, the king your moat did see. But I have been to find in each of three. Oh, what a scene of foolery have I seen, of sighs, of groans, of sorrow and of teen. Where lies thy grief? Oh, tell me, good Dumaine. And gentle Longueville, where lies thy pain? And where my lieges? All about the breast, a cordial ho!
Too bitter is thy jest. Are we betrayed thus to thy overview?
Not you to me, but I betrayed by you. I am honest. I that hold it a sin to break the vow that I'm engaged in. When shall you hear that I will write a thing in rhyme? Or groan for love, or spend a minute's time in pruning me? When shall you hear that I will praise a hand, a foot, a face, an eye, a gait, a state, a brow, a breast, a waist, a leg, a limb?
So, give it away so fast, a true man or a thief that gallops so?
I post from love. Good lover, let me go.
God bless the king!
What present hast thou there?
Some certain treason!
What makes treason here?
Nay, it makes nothing, sir.
It mar nothing neither. The treason and you go in peace away together.
Oh, I beseech your grace, let this letter be read. The parson misdoubts it. 'Twas treason, he said.
Biron, read it over. Where hadst thou it?
Of Custer.
Where hadst thou it?
Of Don Adramadio, Don Adramadio.
Oh, now, what is it?
Why dost thou tear it?
A toy, my liege, a toy. Your grace needs not fear it.
It did move me to passion, and therefore let's hear it.
Why, it is Biron's writing. And here is his name.
You whoresome loggerhead, you are born to do me shame. Guilty, my lord, guilty. I confess.
What?
That you three fools lack me fool to make up the mess. He, and you, my liege, and I.
But Pickpurse is in love, and we deserve to die. Dismiss this audience, and I shall tell you more.
Now we are even.
True, we are four. Will these turtles be gone?
Hence, says away.
Walk aside the true folk, and let the traitors stay.
Sweet lords, sweet lovers, all let us embrace. As true we are as flesh and blood can be. The sea will ebb and flow, heaven show his face. Young blood doth not obey an old decree. We cannot cross the cause where we were born. Therefore, of all hands must we be forsworn.
What did these rent lines show some love of thine?
Did they, quoth you?
Who sees the heavenly Rosaline? Like a rude and savage man of Ind at the first opening of the glorious east, bows not his vassal head, and struck and blind, kisses the base ground with obedient breast. What peremptory eagle-sighted eye dares look upon the heaven of her brow that is not blinded by her majesty?
What zeal, what fury hath inspired thee now? My love, her mistress, is a gracious moon, she an attending star, scarce seen alight.
My eyes are then no eyes, nor I bear own. Oh, but for my love, day would turn to night. Of all complexions, the cold sovereignty do meet as at a fair in her fair cheek, where several worthies make one dignity, where nothing wants that want itself doth seek. Oh, lend me the flourish of all gentle tongues. Fie, painted rhetoric, oh, she needs it not. To things of sale a seller's praise belongs. She passes praise, therefore praise too short doth blot. A withered hermit, 50 winters worn, might shake off 50 looking in her eye. Beauty doth varnish age as if newborn, and gives the crutch the cradle's infancy. Oh, it is the sun that maketh all things shine.
By heaven, thy love is black as ebony.
Is ebony like her? Oh, wood divine. Who can give an oath? Where is a book that I may swear beauty doth beauty lack if she learn not of her eye to look? No face is fair that is not full so black.
Paradox. Black is the badge of hell, the hue of dungeons and the school of night, and beauty's crest becomes the heaven's well.
Devils soonest tempt, resembling spirits of light. Or if in black my lady's brows bedecked, it mourns that painting, usurping hair, should ravish daughters with a false aspect. Therefore is she born to make black fair. Her favor turns the fashion of the days, for native blood is counted painting now, and therefore red, that would avoid dispraise, paints itself black to imitate her brow.
To look like her are chimney sweepers black.
And since her time, Arcadia's counted bright.
And Ethiopes of their sweet complexion crack.
Dark needs no candles now, for dark is light.
Your mistresses dare never come in rain, for fear their colors should be washed away.
For good yours did, sir, for to tell you plain, I'll find a fairer face not washed today.
I'll prove her fair or talk till doomsday here.
No devil will fright thee then, so much as she.
I never knew man hold vile stuff so deep.
Look, here's thy love, my foot in her face, see.
Or if the street were paved with thine eyes, her feet were much too dainty for such tread.
Oh, vile! Then as she passed, what upward lies the street should see as she walked overhead.
What of this? Are we not all in love?
Nothing so sure. And thereby all forsworn.
Then leave this chat, and good Baron, now prove our loving lawful and our faith not torn.
Aye, marry there, some flattery for this evil.
Some authority how to proceed, some tricks, some quillets how to cheat the devil.
Some salve for perjury.
'Tis more than need. Have at you then, affections, men at arms. Consider what you first did swear unto. To fast, to study, and to see no woman. Flat treason gainst the kingly state of youth. Say, can you fast? Your stomachs are too young, and abstinence engenders maladies. And where that you have vowed to study, lords, and that each of you have forsworn his book? Can you still dream and pore and thereon look? For when would you, my liege, or you, in leaden contemplation have found out such fiery numbers as the prompting eyes of beauty's tutors have enriched you with? Other slow arts entirely keep the brain, and therefore, finding barren practices, scarce sure harvest of their heavy toil. But love, first learned in a lady's eyes, lives not alone immured in the brain, but with the motion of all elements, courses as swift as thought through every power, and gives to every power a double power above their functions and their offices. It adds a precious scene to the eye. A lover's eyes will gaze an eagle blind. A lover's ear will hear the lowest sound when the suspicious head of theft is stopped. Love's tongue proves dainty bark as gross in taste. For valor, is not love a Hercules? Still climbing trees and Hesperides. Subtle as Sphinx, as soft and musical as bright Apollo's lute, strung with his hair. And when love speaks, the voice of all the gods makes heaven drowsy with the harmony. Never durst poet touch a pen to write till his ink were tempered with love's sighs. Oh, then his lines would ravish savage ears and plant in tyrants mild humility.
From women's eyes this doctrine I derive. They sparkle still the right Promethean fire. They are the books, the arts, the academes that show, contain, and nourish all the world. Else none at all in aught proves excellent. Then fools you were, these women, to forswear. For keeping what is sworn, you will prove fools. For women's sake, a word that all men love. Or for love's sake, a word that all, loves all men. Or for men's sake, by whom we men are men. Or for women's sake, by whom the authors of these women, let us once lose ourselves to keep our oaths, or else we lose ourselves to find ourselves. It is religion to be thus forsworn, but charity itself fulfills the law, and who can sever love from charity?
Saint Cupid, then, and soldiers to the field.
Advance your standards and upon them, Lord.
Shall we resolve to woo these girls of France?
And bring them, too. Therefore, let's devise some entertainment for them in their tents.
First from the park, let us conduct them there. Then homeward, every man attach the hand of his fair mistress. For revels, dances, masks, and merry hours forerun, fair love, strewing her way with flowers.
Away, away! No time shall be omitted, it may be time, and may by us be fitted.
Satisfied suffice.
Sir, I praise God for you. Your reasons at dinner have been sharp and sententious, pleasant without scurrility, audacious without impudency, and strange without heresy. I did confess this Vendome day with a companion of the king's, who is entitled, nominated, or called Don Adriano de Armado.
Novi hominem tanquam te. His humor is lofty, his discourse peremptory, his tongue fire, his eye ambitious, his gait majestical, and his general behavior vain, ridiculous, and thrasonical.
Thrasonical.
He is too picked, too spruce, too odd, too affected, as it were, too peregrinate, as I may call it.
Peregrinate. A most admirable and choice epithet.
Yes.
Peregrinate.
He stretches out the thread of his verbosity finer than the staple of his argument. I abhor such fanatical phantasmas, such orthodox and point-devised companions, such rackers of orthography as to pronounce doubt fine when he should say doubt. Debt when he should pronounce debt. D-E-B-T, not D-E-T. He cleppeth a calf cough, half hoff, nagebor, vocator, neighbor. Nage, abbreviated nay. This is abominable, which he would call abominable. It insinuateth me of insane.
Insane?
Ane intelligus domine abibet, to make frantic, lunatic.
Oh, laus deo, bone intelligo.
Bony? Bony for bene. Prissian a little scratch. Twill serve, twill serve.
Fidesne quis venit?
Oh, the deo, it's good deo.
Sit up.
Quare chira, not sira.
De no peace, really, and call tell.
Most military, sir. Salutation.
They have been at a great feast of languages and stolen the scraps.
Oh, they have eaten long on the unbasket of words. I marvel thy master hath not eaten thee for a word, for thou art not so long by the head as unerificabilitude in the tativus. Thou art easier swallowed than a flat dragon.
Peace, the peal begins.
Sir. Monsieur, are you not better?
Yes, yes. He teaches boys the horn book. What is A-B spelt backward with a horn on his head?
Bah, puertier with a horn added.
Bah, most silly sheep with a horn. You hear his learning.
Quish, quish, thou consonant.
The third of the five vowels, if you repeat them, or the fifth if I.
I will repeat them. A, E, I.
The sheep. The other two concludes it. Oh, you!
Now, by this old wave of the Mediterranean, a sweet touch, a quick vein you a wit, snip, snap, quick, and home. It rejoiceth my intellect through wit.
And I had but one penny in the world, thou shouldst have it to buy gingerbread. Hold! There is the very remuneration I had of thy master, thou eight-penny purse of wit, thou pigeon egg of discretion. Oh, and the heavens were so pleased that thou were but my bastard. What a joyful father thou shouldst make me. There, thou hast it, odd dunghill, as they say, at the finger's tip.
Oh, oh, I smell false Latin. Dunghill for under.
Arts, man, preambulate. We will be singled from the barbers. But do you not educate youth at the charge house on top of the mountain?
Or Mose, the hill?
Not your sweet pleasure for the mountain.
I do, sans question.
Well, it is the king's most sweet pleasure and affection to congratulate the princess at her pavilion in the posteriors of this day, which the rude multitude call the afternoon.
The posterior of the day, most generous sir, is liable, congruent, and measurable for the afternoon. The word is well culled, chose, sweet and apt, I do assure you, sir, I do assure.
Sir, the king is a noble gentleman, and my familiar, I do assure ye, very good friend. For what is inward between us, let it pass. I do beseech thee, restrain thy courtesy, apparel thy head. And among other important and most serious designs and of great import indeed too, oh, but let that pass. But I must tell thee, it will please his greatness by the world sometime to lean upon my poor shoulder and with his royal finger thus dally with my excrement, with my mustachio, but sweetheart, let that pass. By the world, I recount no fable. Some certain special honors it pleaseth his greatness to impart to our motto, a soldier, a man of travel that hath seen the world. But let that pass. The very all of all is. But, sweetheart, I do implore secrecy that the king would have me present the princess, sweet Chuck, with some delightful ostentation, or show, or pageant, or antique, or firework. Now, understanding that the curate and your sweet self are good at such eruptions and sudden breaking out of mirth, as it were, I have acquainted you with all to the end to crave your assistance.
Sir. Sir, you shall present before her the nine worthy.
Oh,
Sir Nathaniel. Sir Nathaniel, concern some entertainment of time, some show in the posterior of this day, to be rendered by our assistants at the king's command, and this most gallant, illustrate, and learned gentleman before the princess, I say, none so apt as to present the nine worthies.
Where will you find men worthy enough to present them?
Joshua, yourself?
Me?
Myself? Or this gallant gentleman, Judas Maccabeus? The swain, because of his great limb or joint, shall pass Pompey the Great. The page, Hercules?
Pardon, sir. Error. He is not quantity enough for that worthy's thumb. He is not so big as the end of his club.
Shall I have audience? He shall present Hercules in minority.
Oh.
His enter and exit shall be strangling a snake. And I will have an apology for that purpose.
An excellent device. So if any of the audience hiss, you may cry, "Well done, Hercules, now thou crushest the snake." That is the way to make an offense gracious, though few have the grace to do it.
For the rest of the worthies?
I will play three myself.
Thrice worthy gentlemen.
Shall I tell you a thing?
We attend.
We will have, if this fadge not, an antique. I beseech you, follow.
Be a good man, Dove. Thou hast spoke no word all this while.
No understood, nor neither, sir.
Allons, allons, we will employ thee.
I will make one in a dance or so. Bear up on the table to the worthies and let them dance the hay.
Most dull, honest dull. To our sport, away.
Sweethearts, we shall be rich ere we depart, if fairings come thus plentifully in.
A lady walled about with diamonds. Look you what I have from the loving king.
Madam, came nothing else along with that?
Nothing but this. Yes, as much love and rhyme as would be crammed up in a sheet of paper written both sides, the leaf, margin, and all, as he was fain to seal on Cupid's name.
That was the way to make his godhead wax, for he hath been 5,000 years a boy.
Aye, and a shrewd, unhappy gallows, too.
Oh, you'll ne'er be friends with him. He killed your sister.
He made her melancholy, sad, and heavy, and so she died. Had she been light, like you, of such a merry, nimble, stirring spirit, she might have been a grand dame ere she died. And so may you, for a light heart lives long.
What's your dark meaning, mouse, of this light world?
A light condition in a beauty dark.
Oh, we'll need more light to find your meaning out.
Oh, you'll mar the light by taking it in snuff. Therefore, I'll darkly end the argument.
Oh, look what you do. You do it still in the dark.
So do not you, for you are a light witch.
Well bandied both, a set with well played. But Rosaline, you have a favor too. Who sent it and what is it?
I would you knew. And if my face were but as fair as yours, my favor were as great. Be witness this. Oh, nay, I have verses too, I thank your own. The numbers true, and were the numbering too, I were the fairest goddess on the ground. I am compared to 20,000 fairs.
Oh, he hath drawn my picture in his letter.
Anything like?
Much in the letters, nothing in the praise. Beauteous as ink, a good conclusion. But Catherine, what was sent to you from the fair domain?
Madam, this glove.
Oh, did he not send you twain?
Oh, yes, madam. And moreover, some 1,000 verses of a faithful lover. A huge translation of hypocrisy, vilely compiled, profound simplicity.
This and these curls to me sent Longueville. The letter is too long by half a mile.
I think no less. Dost thou not wish in heart the chain were longer and the letter short?
Aye, or I would these hands might never part.
We are wise girls to mock our lovers so.
Oh, they are worse fools to purchase mocking so. That same Biron I'll torture ere I go. Ooh, that I knew we were but in by the week. How I would make him fawn and beg and seek and wait the season and observe the times and spend his prodigal wits in bootless rhymes. And curb his service wholly to my hests, and make him proud to make me proud that jests. So planet-like would I o'ersway his state, that he should be my fool, and I his fate.
None are so surely caught when they are catched as wit turned fool.
The blood of youth burns not with such excess as gravity's revolt to wantonness.
Folly in fools bears not so strong a note as foolery in the wise when wit doth dote.
Oh, here comes Boyette, and mirth is in his face.
Oh, I'm stabbed with laughter. Where's your grace?
Thy news, Boyette.
Prepare, madam, prepare. Arm, wenches, arm. Love that approach disguised, obvious arguments, you'll be surprised. Muster your wits, stand in your own defense, or hide your heads like cowards and fly hens.
St. Dennis to St. Cupid, what are they that charge their breath against us? Say, salt, say!
Under the cool shade of a sycamore, I thought to close mine eyes some half an hour, when lo, to interrupt my purpose rest, toward that shade I might behold addressed the king and his companions. Warily I stole into a neighbor thicket by, and overheard what you shall overhear. That by and by, disguised, they will be here. Their herald is a pretty knavish page who well by heart hath conned his embassage. Action and accent did they teach him there. Thus must thou speak and thus thy body bear. And ever and anon they held a doubt. Presence majestical would put him out. For, quoth the king, an angel shalt thou see. Yet speak not thou, but speak audaciously. The boy replied, an angel is not evil. I had feared her had she been a devil. With that all laughed and clapped him on the shoulder, making the bold wag by their praises bolder.
But what come they that this is
hard? They do, and are appareled thus, like Muscovites or Russians, as I guess. Their purpose is to parley, court, and dance. And every one his love suit will advance unto his several mistress, which he'll know by favors several which they did bestow.
And will they so? The gallant shall be tasked. For ladies, we will every one be masked. And not a man of them shall have grace, despite of suit, to see a lady's face. Hold, Rosaline,
This favor thou shalt wear, and then the king will call thee for his dear. Oh, take thou this, and give me that. So shall Barone take me for Rosaline, and change you favors too. So shall your loves move contrary, deceived by these removes.
Come on then, wear the favors most in sight.
But in this changing, what is your intent?
The effect of my intent is to cross theirs. They do it but in mocking merriment, and mock for mock is my only intent. Their several counsels they unbosom shall to love's mistook, and be mocked withal upon the next occasion that we meet, with visages displayed to talk and greet.
But shall we dance if they desire us to it?
No, to the death we will not move a foot, nor to their pen speech render we no grace. But while 'tis spoke, each turn away her face.
Why, this contempt will kill the speaker's heart and quite divorce his memory from his part.
Therefore I do it. And I make no doubt the rest will ne'er come in if he be out. There's no such sport as sport by sport or thrown to make theirs ours and ours none but our own. So shall we stay, mocking intended game, and they well mocked depart away with shame.
The trumpet sounds, be masked, the master's come.
A holy parcel of the fairest dames that ever turned their backs to mortal view.
Their eyes, villain, their eyes.
That ever turned their eyes to mortal views. Out.
True, out indeed.
Out of your favors, heavenly spirits, vouchsafe not to behold that.
Once to behold, rogue.
Once to behold with your sun beamed eyes. With your sun beamed eyes.
They will not answer to that epithet. You had best call it daughter beamed eyes.
They do not mock me, and that puts me out.
Is this your perfect miss? Begone, you rogue!
What would these strangers know their minds by it? If they do speak our language, 'tis our will that some plain man recount their purposes, know what they would.
What would you with the princess?
Nothing but peace and gentle visitation.
What would they say, they?
Nothing but peace and gentle visitation.
Why, that they have, and bid them so begone.
She says you have it, and you may be gone.
Say to her that we have measured many miles to tread a measure with her on this grass.
They say they have measured many a mile to tread a measure with you on this grass.
It is not so. Ask them how many inches is in 1 mile. If they have measured many, the measure then of one is easily told.
If to come hither you have measured miles, and many miles, the princess bid you tell how many inches doth fill up 1 mile.
Tell her we measure them by weary steps.
She hears herself.
How many weary steps of the many weary miles you have all gone is numbered in the travel of 1 mile?
We number nothing that we spend for you. Our duty is so rich, so infinite, that we may do it still without a cost. Vouchsafe to show the sunshine of your face that we, like savages, may worship it.
My face is but a moon and cloudy too.
Blessed are clouds to do as such clouds do. Vouchsafe, bright moon, and these thy stars to shine those clouds removed upon our watery eyes.
Oh, vain petition!
petitioner beg a greater matter, thou now requests but moonshine in the water.
Then, in our measure, do but vouchsafe one change. Thou bidst me beg. This begging is not strange.
Play music, then. Nay, you must do it soon. Not yet. No dance. Thus change I like the moon.
Will you not dance? Why come you thus estranged?
You took the moon at full, but now she's changed.
But still she is the moon, and I the man. The music plays. Vouchsafe some motion to it.
Our ears vouchsafe it?
But your legs should do it.
As you are strangers and come here by chance, we'll not be nice. Take hands. We will not dance.
Why take we hands then?
Only to part friends. Curtsy, sweethearts. And so the measure ends.
More measure, this measure. Be not nice.
We can afford no more at such a price.
Prize you yourselves. What buys your company?
Your absence only.
That can never be.
Then cannot we be bought? And so adieu. Twice to your visitor and half once
if,
to you.
If you deny to dance, let's hold more chat.
In private, then.
I'm best pleased with that.
White-handed mistress, one sweet word with thee.
Honey, milk, and sugar. There are three.
Nay, then, two trays, and if you grow so nice. With Theglin, Wart, and Momsey. Well, run, Dice, there's half a dozen, please.
Seven sweet adieu. Since you can cog, I'll play no more with you.
One word in secret.
Let it not be sweet.
Thou grievest my gall.
Gall, bitter.
Therefore, meat.
Will you vouchsafe with me to change a word?
Name it.
The fair lady.
Say you so. Fair lord, take that for your fair lady.
So please it you as much in private, and I'll bid adieu.
What? Was your visit made without a tongue?
I know the reason, lady, why you ask.
All for your reason. Quickly, sir, I know.
You have a double tongue within your mask, and would afford my speechless visit half.
Veal, quoth the Dutchman. Is not veal a calf?
A calf, fair lady?
No, a fair lord's calf.
Let's part the word.
No, I'll not be your half. Take all and weave it. It may prove an ox.
Look how you butt yourself in these sharp mocks. Will you give horns chase, lady? Do not so.
Then die a cow before your horns do grow.
One word in private with you ere I die.
Bleat softly, then. The butcher hears you cry.
Tongues of mocking wenches are as keen as is the razor's edge invisible, cutting up finer hair than may be seen about the sense of sense. So sensible seemeth their confidence. Their conceits have wings fleeter than arrows, bullets, wind, thought, swifter things.
Not one word more, my mage. Break off, break off.
By heaven, all dry people with pure scorn.
Farewell, mad wenches. You have simple wits.
20 adieus, my frozen Muscovites. Of wits so wondered at.
Tapers they are, by your sweet breaths puffed out.
Well, liking which they have. Growth, growth. Fat, fat.
Will they not think you hang themselves tonight? Or ever but in visors show their faces? This perperone was not a countenance quite.
Oh, they were all in lamentable cases. The king was weeping ripe for a good word.
Perperone did swear himself out of all suit.
Humane was at my service. And his sword.
No point, quoth I.
My servant straight was mute.
Lord Longaville, said I, came o'er his heart. And try you what he called me.
Quam, perhaps.
Yes, in good faith.
Go, sickness as thou art.
Well, better wits have worn plain statue caps. But will you hear? The king is my love sworn.
And quick Barone had plighted faith to me.
And Longaville was for my service born.
Dumaine is mine, as sure as bark on trees.
Madam and pretty mistresses, give ear. Immediately they will again be here in their own shapes, for it can never be they will digest this harsh indignity.
Will they return?
They will, God knows. Therefore change papers, and when they repair, blow like sweet roses on the summer air.
How blow, speak to be understood.
Fair ladies masked, our roses in their blood. Dismasked, their damask sweet commixture shown, our angel-veiling clouds. All roses blow.
Oh, Vaughn perplexity! What shall we do if they return in their own shapes to room?
Good madam, if by me you'll be advised, let's mock them still as well, known as disguised. Let us complain to them what fools were here disguised like Muscovites in shapeless gear, and and wonder what they were and to what end their shallow shows and prologue vilely penned, and their rough carriage so ridiculous should be presented at our tent to us.
Ladies of the choir, the gallants are at hand.
Whip to our tent, this ruse run over the land.
Fair sir, God save you. Where's the princess?
Gone to her tent. Please, did your majesty command me any service to her thither?
If she thought save me audience for one word.
I will. And so will she, I know, my lord.
This fellow pecks up wit as pigeons peas, and utters the game when God doth please. He's wit peddler, and retails his wares at wakes and wassails, meetings, markets, fairs. I can carve, too, and lift. Why, this is he that kissed his hand away in courtesy. This is the ape of form, Monsieur the Nice, that when he plays at tables chides the dice in honorable terms. Nay, he can sing a mean most meanly, and in ushering mend him who can. The ladies call him sweet. The stairs, as he treads on them, kiss his feet. This is the flower that smiles on everyone to show his teeth as white as whale's bone, and consciences that will not die in debt pay him the due of honey-tongued boyette.
A blister on his sweet tongue with my heart that put our motto's page out of his park.
See where it comes. Behavior, what worth will till this madman show thee, and what art thou not?
All hail, sweet madam, and fair time of day. We come to visit you, and purpose now to lead you to our court. Vouchsafe it, then.
This field shall hold me, and so hold your vow. Nor God nor I delights in perjuring
me. Rebuke me not for that which you provoke. The virtue of your eye must break my oath.
Your nickname, Virtue. Vice you should have spoke, for virtue's office never breaks men's throat. Now by my maiden honour, yet as pure as the unsullied lily, I protest a world of torments though I should endure. I would not yield to be your house's guest. So much I hate a breaking cause to be of heavenly oaths.
Oh, you have lived in desolation here, unseen, unvisited, much to our shame.
Not so, my lord. It is not so, I swear. We have had pastime here and pleasant game. A mess of Russians left us but of late.
How, madam? Russians?
Aye, in truth, my lord. Dreaming gallants, full of courtship and of spirit.
Madam, speak true. It is not so, my lord. My lady, to the manner of the day, is in courtesy gives undeserving praise. We four indeed confronted were with four in Russian habit. Here they stayed an hour and talked apace, and in that hour, my lord, they did not bless us with one happy word. I dare not call them fools, but this I think, when they are thirsty, fools would fain have drink.
This jest is dry to me. Fair, gentle, sweet, your wit makes wise things foolish. Your capacity is of that nature that to your huge store, wise things seem foolish and rich things but poor.
That proves you wise and rich, for in my eyes...
I am a fool and full of poverty.
But that you take what doth to you belong, it were a fault to snatch words from my tongue.
For I am yours and all that I possess.
All the fool mine?
I cannot give you less.
Which of the vizards was it that you wore?
Where? When? What visit? Why demand you this?
There, then, that visit, that superfluous case that hid the worse and showed the better face.
We are decried. They'll mock us now downright.
Let us confess and turn it to a jest.
Amaze, my lord. Why looks your highness sad?
Help! Hold his brows, he'll swoon. Why look you pale? Seasick, I think, coming from Muscovy.
Thus pour the stars down plagues for perjury. Can any face of brass hold longer out?
Here stand I. Lady, dart thy skill at me. Bruise me with scorn. Confound me with a flout. Thrust thy sharp wit quite through my ignorance. Cut me to pieces with thy keen conceit, and I will wish thee never more to dance, nor never more in Russian habit wait, nor never will I trust to speeches penned, nor to the motion of a schoolboy's tongue, nor never come in visit to my friend, nor woo in rhyme like a blind harper's song. Taffeta phrases, silken terms precise, three-piled hyperbole, spruce affectation, figures pedantical.
these summer flies have blown me full of maggot ostentation. I do forswear them, and I here protest by this white glove. How white the hand, God knows. Henceforth, my wooing mind shall be expressed in russet yeas and honest kersey noes. And to begin with, so, God help me, la, my love to thee is sown, sans crack or flaw.
Sans, I pray you.
Yet I have a trick of the old rage. Bear with me, I'm sick. I'll leave it by degrees.
Teach us, sweet madam, for our rude transgression, some fair excuse.
The fairest is confession. Were you not here, but even now disguised?
Madam, I was.
And were you well advised?
I was, fair madam.
When then you were here, what did you whisper in your lady's ear?
That more than all this world I did respect her.
And when she shall challenge this, you will reject her?
Upon mine honor, no.
Peace, forbear. Your oath once broke, you force not to forswear.
Despise me when I break this oath of mine.
I will, and therefore keep it. Rosaline, what did the Russian whisper in your ear?
Oh, madam, he did swear he held me dear as precious eyesight, and did value me above this world, adding thereto, moreover, that he would wed me, or else die my lover.
Oh, God give thee joy of him. This noble lord most honorably doth uphold his word.
How mean you, madam? By my life, my troth, I never swore this lady such an oath.
By heaven, you did! And to confirm it plain, you gave me this. But take it, sir, again.
My faith in this the princess I did give. I knew her by this jewel on her sleeve.
Pardon me, sir. This jewel did she wear. And Lord Verone, my thank you, this mild jewel. Will you have me or your
father? Neither of either. I remit both twain. I see the trick on. Here was a consent, knowing aforehand of our merriment, to dash it like a Christmas comedy. Some carry tale, some please man, some slight zany, some mumble news, some trencherite, some dick that smiles his cheek in years and knows the trick to make my lady laugh when she's disposed, told our intents before. Which once disclosed, the ladies did change favors, and then we, following the signs, would but the sign of she. Now to our perjury, to add more terror, we are again forsworn in will and error. Much upon this it is,
and might not you forestall our sport to make us thus untrue? You put our page out. Go, you are allowed. Die when you will, a smock shall be your shroud. You leer upon me, do you? There's an eye, wounds like a leaden sword.
Full merrily hath this brave menage, this career been run.
Lo, he is tilting straight. Peace I have done. Welcome, pure wit, thou partest a fair prey.
Good, sir. They would know whether the three worthies shall come in or no.
Are there three?
Oh, no, sir, but it is verifying, for every one presents three.
And three threes are nine.
Oh, not so, sir. Under correction, sir. Oh, I hope it is not so. I assure you, sir, you cannot beg us. I hope, sir, three times thrice, sir,
is not nine.
Oh, Lord, sir. We know where until it doth amount.
By Jaws, I always took three threes for nine.
Oh, Lord, sir, it were pity you should get your living by reckoning.
How much is it?
Well, the parties themselves, sir, the actors, sir, will show where until it doth amount. For mine own part, I am but to perfect one man in one poor man. Pompey in the Great, sir.
And thou one of the worthies?
Well, it pleased him to think me worthy of Pompey the Great. For mine own part, I know not the degree of the worthy, but I am to stand for him.
Go with them prepare.
Oh, we will turn it off finely, sir. We will take some care.
Hereon, they will shame us. Let them not approach.
We are shame-proof, my lord. And 'tis some policy to have one show worse than the king's in his company.
I say they shall not come.
Nay, my good lord. Let me all wounded now. That spoke best pleases that doth least know how. Where zeal strives to content, and the contents die in zeal of that which it presents. Their form confounded makes most form in mirth, when great things laboring perish in their birth.
A right description of our sport, my lord.
Anointed, I do implore so much expense at thy royal sweet breath as will offer a brace of wands.
Does this man serve God?
Why ask you?
He speaks not like a man of God's making.
That is all one, my fair sweet honey monarch. for I do protest. The schoolmaster is exceeding fantastical. Too vain. Too vain. But we will put it, as they say, to fortuna di leggera. I wish you the peace of mind. Most royal compliment.
Here is like to be a good presence of worthies. He presents Hector of Troy, the parish curate, Alexander, the swain, Pompey the Great, our model's page, Hercules, the pedant, Judas Maccabeus. And if these four in their first show thrive, these four will change habits and present the other five.
There are five in the first show.
You're deceived, is not so?
The pedant, the braggart, the hedge priest, the fool, and the boy. A bait throughout Novum, and the whole world again cannot pick out five such. Take each one in his vein.
Ship is under sail. Here she comes, a maid.
I, Pompey, am...
You're not he.
I, Pompey, am...
Whoever's head on me.
Well said, old mucker. I must needs be friends with you.
I, Pompey, am Pompey, surname the big.
But great.
Huh?
Oh, it is great, sir.
Pompey, surname the great, that often field with targ and shield did make my foes to sweat. And traveling along this coast, I hear him come by chance and lay my arms before the legs of this sweet lass of France.
If your ladyship would say thanks, Pompey, I had done.
Great thanks, great Pompey.
'Tis not worth so much, but I hope I was perfect. I made a little fault in great.
My head to a halfpenny. Pompey proves the best worthy.
When in the world I lived, I was the world's commander. By north, south, east and west, I spread my conquering might. My scutcheon plain doth show that I am Alexander. Alexander, that I am Alexander. I.
Your nose says no. It stands too right.
Your nose smells no on this most tender smelling night.
How the conqueror is dismayed. Proceed, good Alexander.
When in the world I lived, I was the world's commander.
Most true, 'tis right, you were so, Alexander.
By north, south, east, and west, I spread my conquering might. My scutcheon plain doth show that I am Alexander.
Pompey the Great.
Your servant and custard.
Take away the conqueror. Take away Alexander.
Oh, sir. You have overthrown Alexander the Conqueror. You would be scraped out of the painted cloth for this. Your lion that holds his pole axe sitting on the close stool will be given to Ajax. He will be the ninth worthy.
A conqueror.
And a fear to speak. Run away for shame. Alexander.
When in the world I live.
So please you, a foolish, mild man, look you, and soon dashed. But he is a very good neighbor and a fine bowler. But for Alexander, you see how it is. A little Lord pardon. But we have worthies at coming will speak their mind in some other sort.
Stand aside, great Pompey.
Great Hercules is presented by this imp.
When in the world?
Great Hercules is presented by this imp, whose club killed Cerberus, that three-headed Canis. And when he was a child, a babe, a shrimp, thus did he strangle serpents in his manners. Strangle. What him he seemeth in. Quanium he seemeth in the
authority. Yeah, boy. Kindness of paladin. Keep some speed of my exit and vanish. Judas, I am.
I'm Judas.
Not Iscariot, sir. Judas, I am. He clipped Maccabeus.
Well, Judas Maccabeus clipped is playing Judas.
A kissing traitor. How art thou proved Judas? Judas, I...
The more shame for you, Judas.
What mean you, sir?
To make Judas hang himself.
You are my elder, sir. Begin.
Well followed. Judas was hanged on an elder.
I will not be put out of countenance.
Because thou hast no face.
What is this?
A sudden head.
The head of a basket.
A dead's face in a race.
The face of an old Roman coin, scarce seen.
The helm of Caesar's falchion.
A carved bone face on a flask.
St. George's half cheek and a brooch.
Aye, but a brooch of lead.
I am one in the cap of a tooth drawer. And now forward, for we have put thee in countenance.
You have put me out of countenance.
False. We have given thee faces.
But you have outfaced them all.
And thou art a lion, we would do so.
Therefore, as he is an ass, let him go. It's so adieu, sweet Jude. Nay, why dost thou stay?
For the latter end to his maid.
Oh, for the ass to the Jude? Give it him. Judas, away.
This is not generous. Not gentle. Not humble.
A light from Monsieur Judas. It goes dark. He may stumble.
Alas, poor Maccabeus, how he hath been baited.
Hide thy head, Achilles, here comes Hector in arms.
When my marks come home by me, I will now be married.
Hector was but a Trojan in respect of this.
But is this Hector?
I think he was not so clean, Tim.
His leg is too big for Hector.
Poor calf, sir.
Nay, he's best to do it in the small.
No, this cannot be Hector.
He's a god or a painter, for he makes faces.
The omnipotent Mars, have lens, is the almighty, give Hector a gift.
A gilt nutmeg.
A lemon.
Stuck with cloves.
No, cloves.
Peace. The omnipotent Mars, have lens, is the almighty, give Hector a gift. The heir of Ilion, a man so brave that certain he would fight, yea, from morn till night out of his pavilion. I am that flower.
That columbine.
My sweet blood longing rain thy tongue.
I rather must give it the rein, for it runs against Hector.
Aye, and Hector's a greyhound.
The sweet war man, he's dead and rotten. Sweet chucks beat not the bones of the buried. When he breathed, he was a man. But he will forward with my defiance. And sweet royalty, bestow on me the sense of hearing.
Speak, brave Hector. We are much delighted.
Oh, I do adore thy sweet gracious slipper.
Not so by the foot.
He may not by the yard.
And this Hector far surmounted Hannibal.
Oh, she is gone, fellow Hector, she is gone. She is 2 months on her way already.
What meanest thou?
Oh, unless thou play the honest Trojan, the poor wench is cast away. She's quick. The child brags in her belly already. Tis yours.
Thus thou impanonize me among potentates. Thou shalt die!
Then shall Hector be whipped for Jacquinetta that is quick by him, and hanged for Pompey that is dead by him.
Most rare Pompey!
Renowned Pompey!
Greater than great, 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 great Pompey! Pompey the huge!
Hector trembles!
Pompey has moved! Morate, morate, stir them on, stir them on!
Hector will challenge
you! Aye, we have no more man's blood in his belly than will suffer flee.
Higher than our pole! I do challenge thee!
I'll not fight with a pole like a northern man! I'll slash. I'll do it with my sword. I bepray you, let me borrow my arms again.
Room for the intense rain.
I'll do it in my shirt.
Most resolute, Pompey.
Master, let me take you above your whole lover. Do you not think happy as I'm chasing for the combat? What mean you? You will lose your reputation.
Gentlemen and soldiers, pardon me. I will not combat in my shirt.
You may not deny it. Pompey has made the challenge.
Sweet bloods. Both may and will.
What reason have you for it?
The naked truth of it is, I have no shirt.
I go woolward for penance.
True, it was enjoined him in Rome for want of linen. Since when, I'll be bound, he's worn nothing but a dishcloth of jackanettes, and that he wears next to his heart for a favor.
God save you, madam.
Welcome, Marquis. Oh, thou interruptest our merriment.
I'm sorry, madam, for the news I bear is heavy in my top. The king, your father...
Dead for my life.
Even so. My tale is told.
Worthy's away. The scene begins to close.
For mine own part, I breathe free breath. I have seen the day of wrong through the little hole of discretion. And I will right myself like a soldier.
How fares, your majesty?
Boyard, prepare. I will await tonight.
Madam, not so. I beseech you, stay.
Prepare, I say. I thank you, gracious lords, for all your fair endeavors, and entreat out of a new sad soul that you vouchsafe in your rich wisdom to excuse or hide the liberal opposition of our spirits. If over boldly we have borne ourselves in the converse of breath, your gentleness was guilty of it. Farewell, my worthy lord. A heavy heart bears not a nimble tongue. Excuse me so, coming so short of thanks for my great suit so easily obtained.
The extreme parts of time extremely forms all causes to the purpose of his speed, and often at his very loose decides that which long process could not arbitrate. Though the morning brow of progeny forbid the smiling ecstasy of love, that holy suit which fate would convince, yet since love's argument was first on foot, let not the cloud of sorrow justle it from what it purposed, since to wail friends' loss is not by much so wholesome profitable as to rejoice at friends but newly found.
I understand you not. My griefs are double.
Honest plain words best pierce the ear of grief, and by these badges understand the king. For your fair sakes, have we neglected time, played foul play with our oaths. Your beauty, ladies, hath much deformed us, fashioning our humors even to the opposite end of our intents. And what in us hath seemed ridiculous, as love is full of unbefitting strains, all wanton as a child, skipping in vain, formed by the eye, and therefore, like the eye, full of strange shapes, of habits, and of forms, which particoated presence of loose love put on by us, if in your heavenly eyes have misbecomed our oaths and gravities, those heavenly eyes that look into these faults suggested us to make. Therefore, ladies, our love being yours, the error that love makes is likewise yours. We to ourselves prove false by being once false forever to be true to those that make us both. Fair ladies, you. And even that falsehood in itself a sin thus purifies itself and turns to grace.
We have received your letters full of love. Your favors, the ambassadors of love. And in our maiden council, raise them with courtship, pleasant jest and courtesy, as bombast and as lining to the time. But more devout than this in our respects have we not been. And let your loves in their own fashion, love merrily.
Our letters, madam, showed much more than jest.
So did our looks.
We did not quote them so.
Now, at the latest minute of the hour, grant us thy loves.
A time, methinks, too, my lord. Your grace is perjured much, full of dear guiltiness. And therefore this, if for my love, as there is no such cause, you will do aught, this shall you do for me. Your oath I will not trust. But go with speed to some forlorn and naked hermitage, remote from all the pleasures of the world. There stay until the 12 celestial signs have brought about their annual reckoning. If this austere and sociable life change not your offer made in the heat of blood. If frosts and fasts, hard lodgings and thin weeds nip not the gaudy blossoms of your love, but that it bear this trial and last love, then at the expiration of the year, come challenge me. Challenge me with these deserts, and by this virgin palm kissing thine, I will be thine. And until that an instant shut my woeful self up in a mourning house, if this thou do deny, let our hands part, neither entitled in the other's heart.
If this or more than this I would deny, to flutter up these powers of mine with rest, the sudden hand of death close up mine eye. Hence ever then, my heart is in thy breast.
what to me, my love? But what to me? A wife?
A beard, fair health, and honesty. With threefold love, I wish you all these three.
Oh, shall I say I thank you, gentle one?
Not so. A 12-month and a day will mar no words that smooth-faced wooers say. Come when the king doth to my lady come. Then, if I have much love, I'll give you some.
I'll serve thee true and faithfully till then.
Oh, swear not, lest you be forsworn again.
What says Maria?
At the 12-month end, I'll change my black gown for a faithful friend.
I'll stay with patience, but the time is long.
The liker you, few taller are so young.
Studies, my lady? Mistress, look on me. Behold the window of my heart, mine eye. What humble suit attends thy answer there? Impose some service on me for thy love.
Oft have I heard of you, my lord Biron, before I saw you. And the world's large tongue proclaims you as a man replete with mocks, full of comparisons and wounding flouts, which you on all estates will execute that come within the mercy of your wit. To weed this wormwood from your fruitful brain, and therewithal to win me, if you please, without the which I am not to be won. You shall this 12-month term from day to day visit the speechless sick, and still converse with groaning wretches. And your task shall be, with all the fierce endeavor of your wit, to enforce the pained impotent to smile.
To move wild laughter in the throat of death? It cannot be, it is impossible.
Why, that's the way to choke a jiving spirit whose influence is begot of that loose grace which shallow laughing hearers give to fools. A jest's prosperity lies in the ear of him that hears it, never in the tongue of him that makes it. Then, if sickly ears, deft with the clamors of their own dear groans, will hear your idle scorns, continue them. And I will have you and that fault withal. But if they will not, throw away that spirit, and I shall find you empty of that fault, right joyful of your reformation.
A 12-month. Well, befall what will befall, I'll jest a 12-month in an hospital.
Aye, sweet my lord. And so I must take my leave.
Nay, madam. We will bring you on your way.
Our wooing doth not end like an old play. Jack hath not Jill. These ladies' courtesy might well have made our sport a comedy.
Come, sir. It wants a 12-month and a day. Then it will end.
That's too long for a play.
Sweet Majesty, vouchsafe me.
Was that not Hector?
The worthy knight of Troy.
I will kiss thy royal finger and take leave. I am a votary. I have vowed to Jacquinetta to hold the plough for her sweet love 3 years. But, most esteemed greatness, will you hear the dialogue that the two learned men have compiled in praise of the owl and the cuckoo? It should have followed in the end of our show.
Bring them forth quickly. We will do so.
Hello, approach. This side is fine, it's winter. This fair, the spring. By the owl, the other, by the cuckoo. Well, begin.
When days in pine and violet blue, and maiden's marks are silver white, and cuckoo birds of yellow hue do paint the meadows with delight. The cuckoo then on every tree marks married men, for thus sings he, cuckoo,
cuckoo,
cuckoo, cuckoo, cuckoo. All words appear unpleasing to a married ear.
When icicles hang on the wall, and Dick the shepherd blows his nails, and Tom drags logs into the hall, and milk comes frozen home in pail, and nut be nipped and way be fallen, nightly sings a staring owl to who, to wit to who, a merry Noah, greasy Joan doth keel the pot.
When shepherds pipe on
organ
draws and
merry
the words
of mercury,
when all the wind doth blow, some call upon us a parson's saw, and birds sit brooding in the snow, and Marion's nose is red and raw, and roasted crab hiss in the bowl, and nightly sing the staring owl to went to who a merry noble breezy jones, and there you love the plough and
when carols, trams, and rooks, and owls, and maidens reach their summer smocks, the cuckoo then on every tree mocks Mary's men, for thus sings he cuckoo. Cuckoo, cuckoo, oh, words of fear and pleasing to a merry
deer. To who a merry noble greasy jones doth keel the pot.